Okay, tonight is the 1st of August, 2011, and this is the 16th night. We're talking on the Digha Nikaya Suttas. Now we come to Sutta number 21, Sakkapanha Sutta. This is about Sakka Devaraja who came to ask questions to the Buddha. Thus have I heard, once the Lord was staying in Magadha, to the east of Rajagaha, by a Brahmin village called Ambasanda, to the north of the village on Mount Vedia, in the Indasala cave. And at that time, Sakka Devaraja felt a strong desire to see the Lord. And Sakka thought, where is the Blessed Lord Sammasambuddha now staying? Then perceiving where the Lord was, Sakka said to the 33 gods, gentlemen, the Blessed Lord is staying in Magadha, etc., in the Indasala cave. How would it be if we were to go and visit the Lord? Very good, Lord, and may good fortune go with you, replied the 33 gods. Then Sakka said to Panchasika of the Gandhabas, the Blessed Lord is staying in Magadha, in the Indasala cave. I propose to go to visit him. Very good, Lord, said Panchasika, and taking his yellow baluva wood lute, he followed in attendance on Sakka. And just as swiftly as a strong man might stretch forth his flexed arm, or flex it again, Sakka, surrounded by the 33 gods and attended by Panchasika, vanished from the heaven of the 33 and appeared in Magadha on Mount Vedia. Then a tremendous light shone over Mount Vedia, illuminating the village of Ambasanda. So great was the power of the gods, so that in the surrounding villages they were saying, look, Mount Vedia is on fire today. It's burning, it's in flames. What is the matter that Mount Vedia and Ambasanda are lit up like this? And they were so terrified that their hair stood on end. Then Sakka said, Panchasika, it is hard for the likes of us to get near the Tathagatas when they are enjoying the bliss of meditation and therefore withdrawn. But if you, Panchasika, were first to attract the ear of the Blessed Lord, then we might afterwards be able to approach and see the Blessed Lord Sammasambuddha. Very good, Lord, said Panchasika, and taking his yellow baluva wood lute, he approached the Indasala cave, thinking, as far as this is neither too far nor too near to the Lord, and he will hear my voice, he stood to one side. Then to the strains of his lute, he sang these verses extolling the Buddha, the Dhamma, the Arahants, and love. He said, lady, your father Timbaru greet, O sunshine fair, I give him honor due. By whom was I a maid as fair as you, who are the cause of all my heart's delight? Delightful as the breeze, to one who sweats, or as a cooling draught to one who thirsts. Your radiant beauty is to me as dear as the Dhamma is to the Arahants. Just as medicine to him who is ill, or nourishment to one who is starving still. Bring me, gracious lady, sweet release with water cooled from my consuming flames. The elephant oppressed by summer heat seeks out a lotus pool upon which float petals and pollen of that flower. So into your bosom, sweet, I'd plunge, as an elephant urged by the goat, pays no heed to pricks of lance and spear. So I, unheeding, know not what I do, intoxicated by your beauteous form. By you my heart is tightly bound in bonds, all my thoughts are quite transformed, and I can no longer find my former course. I'm like a fish that's caught on baited hook. Come embrace me, maiden fair of thighs. Seize and hold me with your lovely eyes. Take me in your arms is all I ask. My desire was slight at first, O maid, of waving tresses, but it grew apace, as grow the gifts that Arahants receive. Whatever merit I have gained by gifts to those noble ones, may my reward when it ripens be your love most fair. As the Sakin sun in jhana wrapped, intent and mindful, seeks the deathless goal, thus intent I seek your love, my son. Just as that sage would be rejoiced if he were to gain supreme enlightenment, so I rejoice to be made one with you. If Sakha, Lord of 33 gods, were perchance to grant a boon to me, it's you I'd crave, my love for you so strong. Your father, made so wise, I venerate, like a sal tree fairly blossoming, for his offspring's sake, so sweet and fair. Up here for a moment. So you see, these devas and devis, they also fall in love. And sometimes what they want also they cannot get. When he heard this, the Lord said, Panchasika, the sound of your strings blends so well with your song, and your song with the strings, that neither prevails excessively over the other. When did you compose these verses on the Buddha, the Dhamma, the Arhants, and love? And he said, Lord, it was when the Blessed Lord was staying on the bank of the river Niranjara, under the goat herd's banyan tree, prior to his enlightenment. At that time, I fell in love with the lady Bada, bright as the sun, the daughter of King Timbaru of the Gandhabas. But the lady was in love with somebody else. It was Sikadi, the son of Matali, the charioteer, whom she favored. And when I found that I could not win the lady by any manner of means, I took my yellow baluva wood lute and went to the home of King Timbaru of the Gandhabas, and there I sang these verses. And Lord, having heard the verses, the lady Bada Surya Vachasa said to me, Sir, I have not personally seen that blessed Lord, though I heard of him when I went to the Sudama Hall of the 33 gods to dance. And since, sir, you praise the blessed Lord so highly, let us meet today. And so, Lord, I met the lady, not then, but later. Then Sakha thought, Panchasika and the Lord are in friendly conversation. So he called to Panchasika, My dear Panchasika, salute the blessed Lord for me, saying, Lord, Sakha Devaraja, together with his ministers and followers, pays homage at the feet of the blessed Lord. Very good, Lord, said Panchasika, and did so. And the Buddha said, Panchasika, may Sakha Devaraja, his ministers and followers be happy, for they all desire happiness, devas, humans, asuras, nagas, gandhabas, and whatever other humans, and whatever other groups of beings there are, for that is the way the Tathagatas greet such mighty beings. After this greeting, Sakha entered the Indasala cave, saluted the Lord, and stood to one side. And the 33 gods with Panchasika did the same. Stop here for a moment. So you see just now at the paragraph 1.7, so these devas and devis, they also dance in the hall, just like human beings. Then in this Indasala cave, the rough passages became smooth, the narrow paths became wide, and in the pitch dark cavern, it became bright, owing to the power of the devas. And the Lord said to Sakha, It is wonderful, it is marvelous that the Venerable Kosiya, with so many things to do, should come here. And Sakha Devaraja said, Lord, I have long wished to visit the Blessed Lord, but I have always been so busy on behalf of the 33 that I was unable to come. Once the Blessed Lord was staying at Savati in the Salala hut, and I went to Savati to see the Lord. Stop here for a moment. So you see Sakha Devaraja being the Devaraja, king of the devas, he's also got a lot of responsibilities, very busy, just like human beings. At that time, the Blessed Lord was seated in some form of meditation, and King Vesavana's wife, Bunjati, was waiting on him, venerating him with palms together. I said to her, Lady, please salute the Blessed Lord for me and say, Sakha Devaraja, with his ministers and followers, pays homage at the Lord's feet. But she said, Sir, it is not the right time to see the Blessed Lord. He is in retreat. Well then, lady, when the Blessed Lord rises from his meditation, please tell him what I have said. Lord, did the lady salute you on my behalf? And does the Lord remember what she said? And the Buddha said, She did salute me, Devaraja, and I remember what she said. I also remember that it was the sound of your reverence chariot wheels that roused me from my meditation. Stop here for a moment. So when Sakha Devaraja left in his chariot, the sound of the chariot wheels made the Buddha get up from his get out of his meditation. Lord, those gods who arose in the heaven of the 33 before I did have told me and assured me that whenever a Tathagata, a Sammasambuddha, Arahan arises in the world, the ranks of Devas increase and those of the Asuras decline in numbers. In fact, I have witnessed this myself. There was, Lord, right here in Kapilavatu, a Sakyan girl called Gopika, who had faith in the Buddha, Dhamma, and Sangha, and who observed the precepts scrupulously. She rejected the status of a woman and developed the thought of becoming a man. Then after her death, at the breaking up of the body, she went to a happy destination, being reborn in a heaven state among the 33 gods as one of our sons, becoming known as Gopaka, the Deva's son. Also, there were three monks who, having observed the holy life under the Blessed Lord, had been reborn in the inferior condition of Gandhabas. They lived indulging in the pleasures of the five senses as our attendants and servants. Stop here for a moment. So you see these Gandhabas in the heaven of the 33, they are attendants and servants to the 33 gods, the Devas of the Tavatimsa heaven. At this, Gopaka rebuked them, saying, "What were you about, sirs, that you did not listen to the Blessed Lord's teaching? I was a woman who had faith in the Buddha. I rejected the status of a woman and was reborn among the 33 gods and am known as Gopaka, the Deva's son. But you, after having observed the holy life under the Blessed Lord, have been reborn in the inferior condition of Gandhabas. It is a sorry sight for us to see our fellows in the Dhamma reborn in the inferior condition of Gandhabas." And being thus rebuked, two of the Devas immediately developed mindfulness and so attained to the realm of the retinue of Brahma. But one of them remained addicted to sensual pleasures. Stop here for a moment. So when this Gopaka rebuked the three ex-monks who were born as Gandhabas, two of them felt ashamed and they meditated. They meditated and attained the jhana. First jhana, I was reborn in the Brahma realm. But the other one, he was enjoying life as a Gandhaba, sensual pleasures, so he refused to practice sadhana. Gopaka spoke, "Disciple, once of him who sees, the name I bore then, Gopika. In Buddha, Dhamma, firmly trusting, I serve the Sangha cheerfully. For loyal service paid to him, see me now, a Sakha son, Sakyaputta, mighty in the threefold heaven, resplendent, Gopaka my name. Then former monks I saw, who had reached no higher than Gandhaba's rank, who before had human birth and led the life the Buddha taught. We supplied them food and drink and waited on them in our homes. Had they no ears that they thus bless, still could not grasp the Buddha's Dhamma. Each for himself must understand that Dhamma taught by him who sees and well proclaimed, I, serving you, heard the Noble One's good words, and so I am born, a Sakha son, mighty in the threefold heaven, and resplendent, whereas you, though you serve the Prince of Men and led the matchless life he taught, have reappeared in humble state and not attained your proper rank. A sorry sight it is to see our one's Dhamma fellows sunk so low that Gandhaba spirits, you but come to wait upon the gods, while as for me, I am transformed from household life and female. I am now reborn a male, a god, rejoicing in celestial bliss." Stop here for a moment. So here you see, he rebuked them. He said, "Had they no ears that they thus blessed, still could not grasp the Buddha's Dhamma." So you see, listening to the Dhamma is extremely important. Just meditating, just by meditation and you don't understand the Dhamma, you can't get a high state. If you do both, it's the best. And thus rebuked by Gopaka, a disciple true of Gotama, in sore distress they all replied, "Alas, let's go and strive amain and be no longer other slaves." And of the three, two struggled hard, and bore in mind the teacher's word. They purified their hearts of lust, perceiving peril in desires, and like the elephant that bursts all restraining bonds, they broke the fetters and the bonds of lust, those fetters of the evil one, so hard to overcome. And thus the very gods, the 33, with Indra and Prajapati, who sat enthroned in council hall, these two heroes, passion's purge, outstripped and left them far behind. On seeing which, Vasava, dismayed, chief amidst that throng of gods, cried, "See how these of lesser rank outstripped the gods, the 33. Then hearing of his ruler's fears, Gopaka said to Vasava, "Lord Indra, in the world of men, a Buddha called the Sakin sage has gained the mastery of lust, and these his pupils who had failed in mindfulness when claimed by death have now regained it with my help. Though one of them is left behind and still among Gandhaba's dwells, these two on highest wisdom set, in deep absorption spurn the gods. Let no disciple ever doubt that truth may yet be realized by those who dwell in these abodes. To him who's crossed the flood and made an end of doubts, our homage due, the Buddha, victor Lord, we give. Even here they gain the truth and so have passed beyond to greater eminence. Those two have gained a higher place than this in realms of Brahma's retinue. And we have come, O Lord, in hope that we may gain that truth, and if the Lord will give us leave to put our questions to the Blessed Lord." So you see, these two devas, they practice hard in their meditation, and they gave up this lust. In the heavens, it's very difficult to give up lust, sensual pleasures, because there's so much sensual pleasures. But they felt shame. Felt ashamed, so they practice hard and attain the jhanas. Then the Lord thought, "Sakha has lived a pure life for a long time. Whatever questions he may ask will be to the point and not frivolous, and he will be quick to understand my answers." So the Blessed Lord replied to Sakha in this verse, "Ask me, Sakha, all that you desire. On what you ask, I'll put your mind at rest." Being thus invited, Sakha Devaraja put his first question to the Lord. "By what fetters, sir, are beings bound? Gods, humans, asuras, nagas, gandhabas, and whatever other kinds there may be, whereby, although they wish to live without hate, harming, hostility or malignity, and in peace, yet they live in hate, harming one another, hostile and malign." This was Sakha's first question to the Lord. And the Lord replied, "Ruler of the gods, it is the bonds of jealousy and avarice, Isa Macharya, that bind beings so that though they wish to live without hate, they yet live in hate, harming one another, hostile and malign." This was the Lord's reply. And Sakha, delighted, exclaimed, "So it is, Lord, so it is, welfarer. Through the Lord's answer, I have overcome my doubt and got rid of uncertainty." Stop here for a moment. So Sakha Devaraja says, most beings, we want peace, we don't want to fight and quarrel with each other. And yet we do. Why? And then the Buddha said, because of greed and jealousy. Because of greed, we want this, we want that. And when we see that other people have more than us, we are jealous. This is quite obvious in the world. You can see all around you, people are greedy. And when they have less than what you have, they are jealous of you and try to harm you in some way. Then Sakha, having expressed his appreciation, asked another question. "But sir, what gives rise to jealousy and avarice? What is their origin? How are they born? How do they arise? Owing to the presence of what do they arise? Owing to the absence of what do they not arise?" And the Buddha said, "Jealousy and avarice, Devaraja, take rise from like and dislike. This is their origin. This is how they are born, how they arise. When these are present, they arise. When these are absent, they do not arise." So it's because of liking and disliking. that this desire arises, and when you cannot get what you want, then there is dislike, and there is jealousy. This like is piya, dislike is apiya. But sir, what gives rise to like and dislike? And the Buddha said, owing to the presence, he continued, what gives rise to like and dislike? Owing to the presence of what do they arise? Owing to the absence of what do they not arise? And the Buddha said, they arise, Devaraja, from desire. Owing to the presence of desire, Chanda, they arise. Owing to the absence of desire, they do not arise. And then again he asked, but sir, what gives rise to desire? And the Buddha said, desire, Devaraja, arises from thinking, Vitakka. When the mind thinks about something, desire arises. When the mind thinks about nothing, desire does not arise. But sir, what gives rise to thinking? Thinking, Devaraja, arises from the tendency to proliferation, papancha. When this tendency is present, thinking arises. When it is absent, thinking does not arise. And he asked, well, sir, what practice has that monk undertaken who has reached the right way, which is needful and leading to the cessation of the tendency to proliferation? And the Buddha said, Devaraja, I declare there are two kinds of happiness, the kind to be pursued and the kind to be avoided. The same applies to unhappiness and equanimity. Why have I declared this in regard to happiness? This is how I understood happiness. When I observed that in the pursuit of such happiness, unwholesome factors increased and wholesome factors decreased, then that happiness was to be avoided. But when I observed that in the pursuit of such happiness, unwholesome factors decreased and wholesome ones increased, then that happiness was to be sought after. Now of such happiness as is accompanied by thinking and pondering, and of that which is not so accompanied, the latter is the more excellent. The same applies to unhappiness and equanimity. And this ruler of the gods, or Devaraja, is the practice that monk has undertaken, who has reached the right way, leading to the cessation of the tendency to proliferation. And Sakha expresses delight at the Lord's answer. Stop here for a moment. So, the Buddha is saying here, that there are two kinds of happiness. One is accompanied by thinking and pondering, which is worldly happiness. And that which is not accompanied, that happiness which is not accompanied by thinking and pondering is jhana, especially the second jhana, where there is no more vitaka and vichara. So, for normal people, the ordinary people, there is this tendency to proliferation because they have not tasted the happiness of jhana. So not knowing the happiness, the bliss of jhana, they like to think. So there is this tendency to proliferation. So they think a lot. A lot of people like to think a lot. So because of thinking, because of the tendency to proliferate the mind, to proliferate, that means one thought becomes 10, 10 becomes 100, 100 becomes 1,000. So one is always thinking. And then because of thinking, there is desire. And because of desire, there is like and dislike. And because of like and dislike, there is avarice. And jealousy. Avarice means strong greed. Strong greed. And if you cannot get your greed satisfied, then you have jealousy. Because of like and dislike. But somebody who has attained jhana, and he knows of a bliss which is not accompanied by thinking and pondering, then he prefers not to think. And when he does not think, there is not you don't have the tendency of the mind to proliferate. So you don't have all this. You don't have thinking, you don't have desire, you don't have like and dislike, you don't have avarice and jealousy.